Welcome to the Eyes Lab. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to recreate all of these eyes. If you click and hold on the line segment tool, you can click this little arrow and tear off the tool to see all of the features that we're going to use. To make your Illustrator look like mine, go to Window, Workspace, and choose Essentials Classic. If you still have panels that are set differently than mine, go to Window, Workspace, and click on Reset Essentials Classic. This will reset it to the default Essentials Classic workspace. Let's take a look at the layers. This icon represents the layers. If you don't have it here, all of these panels are available under Window, and there's Layers. You can click and drag out the layer from the name, and you can hide the rest. You can expand this panel, make it bigger or smaller. It's up to you. If you feel that your thumbnails are too small, you can click on the burger menu and choose Panel Options. In your panel options, you can choose large or any other size and click OK. That will make your thumbnails bigger. When you double-click on the layer, you can rename the layer, you can change the reference color, you can turn your layer into a template, or you can dim the images on the layer. I'm just going to leave it as is and click OK. By clicking on the eyeball, you can show and hide the visibility on each of the layers. I'm going to hide the example of the eyes, and as you can see, we have a tracing guide layer here. This layer is locked, so you can't move anything on this layer. Leave the layer locked and select the Draw Here layer. To reveal your guides, you can click Command and Semicolon. Command and Semicolon is a shortcut to show and hide your guides. Guides have already been set up for you. Guides are something we see, so they would be under the View menu. You can choose View, Guides, and there's Show and Hide Guides. You want to leave your guides locked so you don't accidentally move them. So if this says Lock Guides, be sure and check it. If it says Unlock Guides, it means they're already locked. In your toolbar, you have your Line tool. Let's click and hold that. The little arrow indicates that there are more tools underneath this tool that's visible. I'm holding down my mouse button, and I'm clicking on the line tool, and you can see that we have these other options here. If I click the arrow towards the right, this is going to tear off my line tool. Let's start with our first eye. I'm going to click Command Plus to zoom in. Command Minus will zoom out. This is a shortcut. You can also hold your Alt or Option key and use your mouse scroll function to zoom in and out. Spacebar will access the hand tool while you're using any of the tools in the toolbar so you can move your canvas. Starting with the first eye, we're going to start with the line tool. Make sure you have your line tool selected, and I want you to click and drag. Press and hold shift while you're dragging, release with your mouse button, and then release with the shift button. If your line doesn't match the lines that are here, all we need to do is change the stroke weight. This stroke is 15 pixels. Select 15 pixels from your pull-down while you're on the line tool. Notice that the settings in your control panel will change depending on which tool you have selected. Be sure you have your smart guides turned on. Smart guides are these pink lines that show up as I move my cursor around. To turn on your smart guides, go to View and make sure smart guides is checked. As you can see, our line doesn't match the line that we have in our tracing guide. Let's open up our stroke tool, and I'm going to click and drag to bring it over here. I can close this. To expand this panel, there's this small double-headed arrow beside the word stroke. Let's click that until you see profile uniform at the bottom. There are different states to this panel. Just be sure you open up this panel all the way. We want to change the cap end on this stroke, so we're going to choose the round cap. That adds the rounded cap to the stroke. We can close the stroke panel, and we can choose our selection tool. The shortcut is V on the keyboard. Also, when you're on the line tool, you can press and hold Command, which will access the Move tool. I'm going to click and drag this down slightly. You can also use your arrow keys, tap this up and down. When you're happy with your line, press and hold Command so your Move tool is displayed, and you can click away to deselect. If you want to, you can show and hide your guides by pressing Command and Semicolon to see what you've done. Next, we're going to make the spiral. We're going to choose the spiral tool. This is an awkward tool. I'm going to select the spiral tool, and I'm going to click and drag. And as you can see, the spiral is going in the opposite direction. I'm going to press Delete. If I press and hold my Alt or Option and click once, anywhere, it brings up the spiral tool menu options. First of all, I'm going to change the direction of my spiral. I also noticed that there were too many segments on my spiral, so I'll bring it down by two. Everything else, I'll leave the same and click OK. It automatically draws the spiral for you. We're going to delete that, and we're going to start again. Click and drag. While you've got your mouse button down, press and hold the spacebar. When you're holding the spacebar, you can move your spiral around on the canvas. Release your spacebar and reposition your spiral. Spacebar, shift it into place, release spacebar, shrink it down slightly, spacebar, shift it into place, release spacebar, twirl it more, spacebar, shift it into place, release spacebar, make it slightly bigger, spacebar, shift it into place. I'm happy with this. I'm going to release my spacebar, but notice that I have a segment, an extra segment at the end of my twirl, which I need to get rid of. My mouse button is still down. I'm going to press my down arrow one time, and that will remove that segment. If I press up, I can add more segments. If I press down, I can remove segments. Once you're happy, you can release your mouse button and it will place your spiral where you've left it. Again, pressing and holding command, you can access your move tool and you can shift your spiral into a better place. Don't worry if it's not perfect. This one is hard to get perfect. If we press V on our keyboard to access our black arrow or move tool, you see that we get this bounding box around our spiral. This bounding box lets us make it bigger. I can distort this. I don't want to. If you press and hold shift, this will constrain the proper proportions. I'm going to slightly enlarge this and release. The other thing you can do with the bounding box is when you hover over any of the corners, you can rotate your artwork as well. So I'm just going to rotate this and tap it with my arrow keys just to move it into place. And there we go. The next piece we're going to create is the circle within the center of the eye. The circle tool is part of the shapes. If we click and hold the rectangle, you'll see that you have other shape tools available. We're just going to use the ellipse tool for now. Select the ellipse tool. We're going to start at the center to draw our eye. You can try drawing a circle. Click, drag. You can move your mouse around. When you press and hold shift, this constrains your proportion so it stays a perfect circle. You release with your mouse first and then with your keyboard keys. Let's delete this and try that again. I'm going to start at the center, and my smart guides tell me this would be the center of my eye. I'm going to click, drag, press and hold shift so I get a perfect circle, and then I'm going to press and hold option or alt. That means my circle will be drawing out from the center. I'll release with my mouse button, then I'll release with my alt and shift keys on my keyboard. I'll press V on my keyboard just so I access my move tool. With my arrow keys, I will tap my circle into place. Next, we're going to create the line over here. With our line tool selected again, we're going to click, drag, press and hold shift, and just before our curvature at the end of our line happens, I'm going to release. For this eye, this is all I want you to do. Let's move on to the next eye. For this eye, we'll be using a couple more tools. Let's start by creating the actual shape of the eye itself. I want you to choose your ellipse tool. Starting from the center, we're going to click, drag, press and hold Alt so it comes out from the center. Don't press Shift because it will be too perfect. I want you to drag it out to here and release. Select A. This selects your white arrow tool or your direct selection tool. By using this arrow tool, you are able to select the points as individuals rather than the object or shape or line as a whole. Command Z will undo your last move. What you can do is select this corner of the eye, take your first handle, click and drag, and press and hold shift so you're dragging straight right into the center. Do the same thing with the bottom handle, and then we're going to do the same thing with this side. Select it, click the top handle, drag, press and hold shift right to the center, click, drag, press and hold shift. Now what we can do is we can adjust the height of the eye just by selecting this singular dot and bringing it down, and this singular point and bringing it up. That's how we create an eye shape in Illustrator. Next, we're going to create the rings within the eye. These are evenly spaced, and we're not going to do it manually. We're going to use the polar grid tool. This will give us this look automatically. So select the polar grid tool. Starting in the center, we're going to click, drag, press and hold shift, press and hold alt while our mouse button is down, and get it to about the size that we need, something like this. Now, when I release my shift and I release my alt, you can see that it goes back where my mouse positioning is. So you can just repress shift and alt and you can see what you've got. I've got 1, 2, 3 lines in my tracing guide, and I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in my polar grid tool. I need to get rid of 2 of the circle rings. So what I'm going to do is release my option and shift and press my down arrow. 1, 2. Now when I press and hold my alt and shift, you can see that the circle shapes will match up a bit better. I also have the lines coming out from the center. So if I press my left and right arrows, I can get rid of those lines. Pressing my left arrow and the lines are gone. Again, I'm going to press and hold alt and shift. I'm going to take my thumb and move over to the space bar just to shift that up slightly. And then I'm going to release space bar with my thumb. I've still got Alt and Shift down. I'm going to release with my mouse button, and then I'll release my Alt and Shift. We need to get rid of this top portion of the circle to make it work perfectly. If you want to see your original tracing guide, you can always hide your draw here layer so you can see and make sure everything works. Looks good. To remove this top part, we're going to need to use the scissors tool. I also would like to see the actual lines of my drawings. So I'm going to press Command Y. Command Y gives us an outline view of our drawing. I'm going to zoom in, and here is my problem area, which I need to get rid of. The shortcut for the scissors tool is C. It's over here on the toolbar too. It will be under your eraser tool. I'm going to highlight right over this path, right on the line where the eye and the circle meet. I'm going to click once. I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. My path is highlighted in red, the one I want to cut. So I'm going to click once. Pressing and holding Command, I'm accessing the last arrow tool that I had selected, which happens to be the white arrow tool in this case, which is fine. I can select my line at the top and press Delete twice. And that will get rid of that. My cut was slightly off. If I press and hold my command, I can click that and I can move it down slightly if I wanted to make it extra perfect. I'm going to zoom out, command minus, and I'm going to press command Y to bring back my original drawing. Because these lines are so thick, you sort of see a bump there. We can always change our stroke by going to Window, Stroke, and we can get rid of the round cap, which creates a protruding edge. Be sure and select the problem path or line with your black arrow tool. Notice that these are all grouped together. I'm gonna select the unfortunately named butt cap, and that will help get rid of that extra bump. Leave your stroke panel open. The next one we're going to create is the bottom dotted eyelash line. Let's choose our line tool, and we're going to drag a line from here right across to here. Pressing and holding Shift, release my mouse button, release Shift. On our stroke panel, we're going to select dashed line. Because we had chosen the butt cap, the dashed line is going to give us a square line. Let's change it to the rounded cap to get something more rounded. The length of the dash is 12 pixels. Let's change that to 0 and press Tab to move over to the next space. The gap has nothing entered, so it will still look like a line. Let's try a gap of 25px and press Tab. Then we get more of a dotted line. The weight of our line is 15 pixels. Let's bring that down to 10 pixels. Now all we have to do is curve the line. The reason why our dash is set to 0 is because imagine if we put a spacer in between the rounded caps. The spacer, let's say even if it's 1 pixel, Tab, you'll see that it creates just a little bit of space between the two round cap ends, which makes it into a bit of a pill shape. If we had no little spacer there, all we have are the two round cap ends with nothing in between stuck together, which creates a circle. That's how we get the circle dotted line. Let's curve this stroke. I'm going to choose my selection tool, and I'm going to go to Object, Envelope Distort, Make with Warp. As you can see, we're going to use the Arc tool. By default, it's set to 50%. We're going to bend this the opposite direction, something around 45%, maybe even 50, whichever one you think looks best. And select OK when you're happy with it and click away. It won't match up perfectly, but that's okay. Next, let's work on the top lash line. Same thing, we're going to choose our line tool. We're going to draw a line about the length of the eye, maybe slightly longer. Notice that I don't have any color selected on my line, so if I were to deselect it, it would disappear. The path is still there. A path is like a skeleton. It's always there. It's the backbone of all your lines. The stroke that we put on the line would make our line look complete. So let's add a 10-point stroke. You can also change the weight of the stroke here within your stroke panel. Let's choose the rounded cap. Maybe we'll make this a 12-point stroke. Next, I want to draw an eyelash. So I'll start here, click, drag, and release. So I'll create another one about here, pressing and holding Shift. And you'll see that your smart guides tell you where you're lining up. And I'll create another one about here, click, drag, press and hold Shift. If it looks slightly shorter, you can choose your A or your direct selection tool. You can select the top point of your eyelash and tap up with your arrow keys just to move it up slightly. Something else you can do to be sure that all of the top of your eyelashes are the same height is with the white arrow tool or direct selection tool, you can click drag. This is called marquee selecting because we're creating a marquee, or like that dotted rectangle. We're going to marquee select around the top of all of these points so it selects each one of them. Then we're going to go up here to our control panel, and you see this is our alignment tab. We're going to align them to the top. So I'm going to click that button once. Did you see that? They all became the same height. Another way of duplicating your eyelashes is by choosing the V tool, or the black arrow tool, hovering over the object you want to select, and press and hold Alt. Nothing happens, but when you press and hold Alt, and then you click and drag, you can see that I get the duplicate arrows, meaning I am copying this. Then you press and hold Shift, and it will snap into the exact place where you need it to be. And release with your mouse, and then release with your Alt and Shift keys. Let's do that one more time. Alt, click, drag, press and hold Shift, and release. I want to make sure these are all in perfect alignment and have perfect spacing between them. I'm going to select these four lashes, and again in my alignment tools, there is the horizontal distribute center. You can click that once, and everything will align with perfect spacing between each other. If this isn't working for you, be sure that in this dotted box, you click the down arrow, be sure it's set to align to selection. That means these strokes are aligning to themselves or anything that's selected. Let's take the center tool, press and hold Alt, click and drag, press and hold Shift, release with my mouse, release with my Alt and Shift keys. Last time, press and hold Alt, click, drag, press and hold Shift, release. Doesn't matter where you put them, as long as the first and last lines are in place, when we select them all with our black arrow tool and we align them horizontally, they'll align perfectly between the first and last strokes. So there you have it. There's our eyelashes. We need to warp it to put it into shape. Let's select the entire piece, and we're going to go to Object, Envelope Distort, Make with Warp. We're going to choose about 50% horizontal and click OK. With my black arrow tool or move tool, I can shift my eyelashes into place, and then I'll take one end and move it slightly inwards, take the other end and do the same thing. And that's how we can create the eyelashes. Rather than recreating this shape of the eye, let's take the shape from this one. If we click this, we'll press and hold Alt, click drag, press and hold Shift, and release. This time, we're going to get rid of the outer rings and leave the radial lines. Select your polar grid tool and let's start from the center. I'm going to click, drag, press and hold Alt, and press and hold Shift to get the roundabout size of what I'm looking for. Now, I don't want any circular center lines. All I want are the radial lines coming from the center going outwards. I'm going to release my Alt and Shift and keep my mouse button down. And I'm going to press my down button to get rid of these circles. And I'm going to press my right button to bring back these lines. Something like that should work. Alt and Shift. For some reason, the lines disappear when I press Alt and Shift, so I'm just going to press right. Let's do two more times, Alt and Shift, and that seems to work out. I'm going to release with my mouse button, then release with my keys, and there I've got the radial lines coming out from the center. If you find you lose your picture, you can always press Command 0. When I press Command, I select my black arrow or move tool. I can click away to deselect. Let's look at our draw here arrow. Now, we need to create this inner circle, so I'm going to use my circle tool, or my ellipse tool, over here in my toolbar, and again in the center, click, drag, press and hold Alt, press and hold Shift, and create that circle right about there like that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to fill it with white, so I can press the default fill and stroke to use the shortcut, and I get the default fill and the stroke. Now, the stroke is too thin, or doesn't have enough weight, so I'm going to up the weight on that to, let's try 10, and that's too small. Let's try 15, and that looks good. And there we go. That's how we deleted the other lines behind it, just by using a fill color. So anywhere I put this, you can see it's got the white fill. I'm just going to match it back up. I want to show you another way to match things to the center. If you drag them right out of place and you select that center point, you can click and drag it back and you can find that center. There it says intersect. You can release. Last but not least, let's create this curved eyelash. This requires the use of two tools. We're going to use the arc tool and the spiral tool, and we do need to connect them to make sure that they become one line. Let's start with the arc tool. Rather than starting from this corner and trying to work our way up, we're actually going to start from this section and drag downwards. So let's click, drag, and as you can see, it's completely in the wrong direction. So while I've got my mouse button down, I can press F on my keyboard, and that's going to flip the direction of my curve. I'll do something like that, and I'll release. Next thing I'm going to do is choose my white arrow tool or my direct selection tool, and I can select that one anchor point, and I can shift it slightly over. Now you can also move these handles and you get a different type of curve. You can select something that looks good to you. As you can see, this one here is slightly off based on my stroke. So I'm going to tap that one point and use my arrow keys just to tap it in slightly so it's a nice match. Deselect just by clicking away. Next, I'm going to choose my spiral tool. And it remembers our settings from last time. I'll click and drag and the spiral is going in the right direction. In case you forgot, while my mouse button is down, I'm going to press and hold the space bar and just shift it sort of into place. So it looks like that's a perfect fit. Click, drag, and turn, move my mouse down slightly. Once you've got it basically in the correct position, you're going to release. Notice that I don't have the round cap on these. That's fine. We don't need to worry about that just now. To connect these two lines together in this sort of curvature formation, what we need to do is select this first line, press and hold our Alt to duplicate it, move it over here. Now that we have the bounding box around this, because I have my move tool selected, I can hover over the edges and I can turn it somewhat like this. Now it is slightly larger, which is fine. I'm going to change the size. I'm going to click and drag this to about here. And maybe I'll click and drag that about there. They should be almost touching. So it's going to look somewhat like this. Now I need to choose my A or my direct selection tool. And I'm going to select the two points here. Notice how they're not on top of each other. We want to take these two points and select them and put them directly on top of each other. So we're going to go to Object, Path, and average, meaning it's going to take both points and average out the space. It'll probably be right about there, where it's going to put them directly on top of each other, like that. Once they're averaged out, we need to join them. So they are both still selected, so we're going to press Command J to join them. Notice how this becomes one solid line now. Okay, you can also take these points and you can move them so it's not such a big indent. You can take that point, you can slightly move it out just to shift it around a bit. Next, we're going to do the same thing over here to connect the two lines. We're going to select them both. They're not on top of each other. And even if they look like they're on top of each other, you should still go to Object, Path, and Average just to let the computer do the work and select OK. Now they're perfect. Command J to join them. And again, using our white arrow tool, or direct selection tool, we can straighten out the two handles and we'll get a nice curve. I'm just gonna zoom out, better look. Okay, this curve looks a bit too long there, so I'm just gonna shift it over this way slightly, maybe lengthen it. And this is something that takes a little bit of time to get used to. You can click away and you can see that there's a slight divot there. I'm gonna press Command Y just to see the outlines of everything that I've done here. This is my outline and you can see that I do have a little bit of a divot there. So I'm gonna press Command Y again to bring back my original. And I will shift this slightly that way. That helps get rid of the dent. And there we go, that's how we create the eyelash. One thing you may have noticed is this goes from thick to thin. So let's recreate that. On your draw here layer, for this to work, you have to make sure that now this is all one solid piece. We started with one arc, two arcs, and then a spiral. So these three pieces should all be one piece now. What we're gonna do is up here in your control panel or in your stroke panel, you have a profile. Okay, I prefer to go up here in the control panel to arrange this, only because your brush definition needs to be on basic for this to work. Otherwise, it won't work. So be sure you've selected your eyelash line, set your brush definition to basic. Then we're going to choose the thick to thin. You can try this one, which is going in the opposite direction. The width profile in our stroke panel, you see that we do have the option to flip along the path in a different direction. Because it by default comes out like this, we actually need to flip it so we get the thick to thin. And there you have it. We've created the eyes. When you're done, I'd like you to save the file. So just go to File, Save As, save it as your name, _ eyes. Go over to Blackboard, under Assignments, click on the upload link for Eyes Lab, and upload it there. Thank you so much.